artist Adrian Ward. Usually I'm half crazed madman running around here desperately trying to get everything finished by some ridiculous time frame. So much the time frame, it's actually the fact that there's an infinite amount of things to do. It seems like that. It's fantastic because it allows me to swim through the endless materials I can use as a sculptor and create the things that I'm wanting to do on the run, which is great because that means you don't have to think about it too much. What I'm going to be doing today is starting a project which I think is quite which is casting pure silver bullion and gold bullion as well. So basically Wollongong University has a campus in Dubai, and they've had that for 25 years and it's their silver anniversary. So what they're wanting to do is they're wanting to deliver some kind of silver gift to the Sultan of Brunei, I think, or a Sultan. It was basically a book with some writing that they had, and I said, look, that sounds great, but let's take it to the next level. Let's make it a contemporary thing. There was different cultural issues, I have to admit, with the idea of the book and certain religious traditions over there. So I'm going to sort of lightly touch on those in the piece, but basically this book is going to be transitioning and glitching into kind of existence. Now, looking into the visual glitches of technology on a screen, but trying to do that in a sculptural form. So all of that you'll be seeing in the video over the next couple of videos. Welcome to the studio and let's get started. Yeah, so this section's a little higher than the rest of the studio. This is basically an old carport. When I mean old, I mean 100-year-old carport. Up in this section, I do a lot of the moulding and the sort of detailed stuff. And you know what's really handy? I've hard rubbish is my world. And to be truthful with you, God does speak to me through hard rubbish. It's quite weird because I'll be driving along thinking, oh, I need something like that. And look over there and sure enough, God's left me a pile of perfect rubbish that I need on the side of the road with the very thing that I need. I found these marble slabs here, which are quite handy for doing the moulding work. You want a nice clean surface that the rubber's just going to peel off. And any moulding materials that you're using, even plaster, you get the old spatula here, just scrape it straight off. Back to the project. For an old book, and luckily I found in an op shop, of course, another great place to discover exactly what you need. It's definitely going to be sacrificed. Now, I don't feel sad about sacrificing a 100-year-old book, because this particular one, which is called Old Pinkin Days, a colloquial term from Old England. But basically it looks like a sports book. And sports jokes and other racist little tidbits from 100 years ago. I don't know if I'll show you the other picture. It's a little coarse, but let's skip on that. But definitely this book could be sacrificed. I'm not sure how it lasted 100 years. Like, who'd bother? It's obviously meant for this. Like I say, God talks to me through materials. I started to work on covering a motherboard. Now, motherboards are extremely detailed, I mean, like on a level that is supernatural, certainly not human, it's technological, but it molds up wonderfully if you can get all the detail. So I've got to break this mold out. I'm not even sure if I've done this right, so I'll just struggle away with that. And we'll cut to when it's all finished and it looks like I know exactly what I'm doing. But basically what I've got here is a hard shell, which is the housing of the mold. And you'll be able to put the rubber back into that housing. Okay. I'm going to give you all my secrets away. Well, not all of them, but most of them. This is like a little Kleenex wipe that is extremely strong. And so when you're putting the rubber into what you do, a layer of rubber, you can see I've done one layer of rubber there. And then as that's remotely set, I've laid down this layer of gauze, or you know, the Kleenex, and then I put a bit more rubber on top so the housing didn't stick. So let's see if we can pull it off. It's absolutely coming off fantastic. Now, let me just tell you one thing. Never forget to put a release agent on any object, okay? Because I've made big mistakes with it. So this is a little footnote. And look, it looks like there's almost no detail in that. And yet, when it comes out, I mean, it looks completely uninspiring, I have to say. I don't know if you can see that, but actually when I looked under the and had the light reflecting off the rubber, there is detail on there like you wouldn't believe. And amazingly, that does come out in the silver eventually. And it's wonderful to have that because, you know, there's no way I could ever create anything on that level of precision. I don't know if you guys can see it, but you'll see it soon enough. So usually I've got this little tin here that's quite good. And now we can get this reasonably warm. The temperature of wax is a whole world unto itself. Because the different viscosities that the wax goes through has a world of difference. So obviously with this level of detail, I want to keep it quite hot. Right, I've just come back here and I noticed that there, when I opened up the cooker here, the wax was slightly smoking. Now that's not what you want, because A, it burns the wax, which wrecks your wax, not cheap. And also it just basically lowers the whole structural integrity of the wax. And we don't need it that hot. So bring it down a notch. I've sacrificed a brush, which was extremely hard to do. But I do it for a good cause. You know what I'm going to do here? I'm going to heat this up with a tad. So that wax is going to love going into that rubber. I was just doing a little bit of work over with Sam Jinks, another Melbourne artist who works in a sort of hyper-realistic form. And he uses a hell of a lot of monster clay. I'll just show you that. And I wasn't really used to monster clay. I hadn't really seen it, but I used to make my own modeling clay. What I'm finding is it's bubbling up. The brush is bubbling up, which means it's cooking basically, which is not what we really want. But let's just jump in. Ooh, that's not good. But this is how we learn. Let's just massage that wax right into it and just get detail in there. It's beautiful and hot. So it just runs like liquid. I'm just chucking it on everywhere because I don't really care about getting a mess. I'm caring about the detail. Oh, Jesus. Ah! Oh, oh, God, that tin's so hot. That's what happens when you start to be a little lackadaisical. Let's keep going after I've just given myself some slight burns. I'm putting it in there, but for some reason it's just melting through. But we'll just build up the layer of clay. And now you can definitely drop your wax down, your wax temp. Because once you've got that first layer of detail, you can start to thicken it up. And you'll find that the wax, as it cools down, it gets nice and thick. And you can really make some mileage. Let's see how this is looking here. It's still warm, but it's got its structure enough that we can gently kind of peel that off. But you can see there, that's pretty much the motherboard. Now the motherboard was not your run-of-the-mill computer, it's a laptop, which has even greater levels of detail, I have to say. And it's, you know, from a sculptural level, it's multi-layered. On the level of detail, it's just stunning. And obviously people don't make these things as machines. So that's quite good.